And now, The Bonfire with Big J. Okerson and Dan Soder.
Today, dude, let's just mix it up, and I say let's just go right to the phone lines. Brendan, who do we got? Brendan?
Brendan? Oh, God.
Let's go to the phone lines. We have anybody on line one?
Oh, God.
No Brendan today. What happened? Another paternity leave. Did we lose another one of the paternity leave?
God, what is it about our staff and just fucking...
Man, pull out once in a while, you fucking dirty dogs.
God damn.
It is the bonfire... Faction Talk, Sirius XM 103, Big J. Okerson, Dan Soder.
How you doing?
We have the rest of the crew here. We got Christine Evans is Christ only knows where.
Her man, I'll tell you, Lou Jacob and I were talking about it before the show. Pure chaos. She just puts on a camera and then you just watch chaos happen.
Christine, looks like pure chaos, dude.
Yeah, it's like watching Christine get ready. Lou was like, it always comes in. It's always a storm.
Never just smooth sailing.
You know what it is? I didn't realize this the entire time quarantine. Christine has been your bonfire roadie, where she's like your guitar tech. Like she's like sets it up and she gets ready on the side, and then you just come in and you're like, "Hello, everyone."
I set it up pretty much myself. Today all she did was hit the connect button on the thing today. I'll set it up.
From where it looks like from us, from like where we watch it. We just watch like the video of because she always starts the meetings, the video meetings. So we see her first.
Yeah. Well, trust me, Christine's chaos is at an all time high. She needs to be sedated, I would guess, like a zoo bear.
Is she like one of those Central Park? Is she like one of those Central Park horses?
She got loose. I don't know what happened. She's becoming self aware, but she is saying banana shit lately. I mean, all over the place. Watching Tina.
Oh, you watched the Tina Turner doc?
Yeah, Dan, I trust you did too because you told me to watch it, remember?
Oh, yeah. No, I watched it.
Okay, you swear to God?
Yeah, swear to God I watched it.
Front to back.
You know I'm a big Ike Turner guy. You know
I learned a lot of things in that documentary. I learned that simply the best is Mount Rushmore of good versus terrible chorus.
Can we also please bring up the original English version of Simply the Best? Did you see that band?
You're talking about What's Love Got to Do with It.
Oh, shit. Yeah. What's Love Got to Do with It. Yeah, you're right. The What's Love Got to Do with It original video. Jacob, did you watch the Tina Turner doc?
Oh, yeah. I watched it. What's Love Got to Do? I was so excited.
But they're just humping where they're like, What's Love Got to Do? Got to Do. Like, this is it.
Wildly talented woman. Beautiful. Very sexy woman. And also, when I learned that episode, dumb as a bag of bricks. I mean, when she... talked about turning it all over to fucking Buddhism. And then she was like, and that fucking Tina Turner voice going, ha la shalabim, shalahumba, humba, shalabim, fu hey, am hu ya.
The rest of his life.
And she's like, I'm going to fight this motherfucker.
Yeah, dude, that fight that they got into where she starts fighting back in the cab, that cab driver must have been like, oh, shit. Because in the documentary, Tina Turner explains, by the way, we're talking about the documentary Tina. You can watch it on HBO Max. But she talks about she found Buddhism, and then through chanting Buddhism, it gave her a way out of her and Ike Turner's relationship, which was just, hellaciously
abusive. She had a fistfight with him in a limousine. She had a fistfight with him.
That was the day she fought back. But Ike Turner hearing about anything with Buddhism the rest of his life, where he goes, man, fuck Buddha.
Fuck that shit.
He fucked up a good thing for me. That Buddha, that fat motherfucker.
Little fat man sitting on a pillar. Fuck that motherfucker.
He scooped her up when she was 17. and then just like, you know.
That's the move, dude. That's the fucking Sonny Bono. That's the Sonny Bono move, dude. Early.
Was Cher 17 when she got?
And then when they get out of 16. Control. When they get out of control, you know, you got to reel them back in.
What was Sonny Bono doing in Fresno?
What was he not doing in Fresno?
Have you been to Fresno?
Young Armenian girls. You shave a couple of them down, dude. You might find something nice underneath.
Dude, he was like, they were like, what are you doing here, little man? And he goes, I'm finding gold.
Yeah.
I'm
going to go find me a bride.
I'm Sonny Bono. One day I'm going to run this place.
No, that documentary was pretty bizarre. It was good. I thought it was very good, but I also wasn't much. I guess I'm a Tina Turner fan, I suppose, because I completely knew the whole story.
I didn't realize
I wasn't surprised by anything.
Because I was young, I didn't realize her peak was when it showed her in stadiums with a mom jeans on and a white t-shirt. I always thought when I was younger that she had that as a young woman, so I didn't realize that was actually her blowing up at that point. I didn't realize the mom jeans were
No, by the time it got to mom jeans, she was already many stadiums. Times around the world stadiums. Many times around the world stadiums. She kept it pretty sexy for pretty long. And then she went old woman sexy. So I'll be honest with you. Up until they showed her that movie premiere being carried around like a fucking like a corpse on parade, she was pretty.
Dude,
except when she sings, she was an ugly singer. When she sings, she looks like she's 80 years old, even when she was like in her 30s. Because
she's got stank face. She's like, yeah. But Jay,
when she smiles,
the one thing I wanted to talk to you about when I watched the whole documentary, the thing that I kept thinking about after I watched it is you're right. At the very end, they show her going to the Broadway premiere of the Tina Turner musical. Mm-hmm. And she, they're walking her around like Jake LaMotta. She's just like going and like shaking hands.
Champ, can I get a picture real quick? She's like, yeah, sure. Yeah.
She does the leg thing. That's her boxing.
You just got a squiggly autograph. Says like, simple, the best.
I ordered Richard Pryor's book offline before he died, and it's autographed like that, where you're like, oh, he definitely did this.
God, yeah, this is definitely by him. Or a hilarious forger.
someone knows exactly how to forge him at this stage.
Someone did that a long time. I forget what it was, SNL joke maybe or something, where they were like, something about they knew it was legal because it had Michael J. Fox's autograph, and it was just like a bunch of like fucking lines squiggly all over a paper.
Yeah. Well, Tina, when they bring Tina Turner out for the curtain call of the Broadway play, it's her, and then it's a lady playing her, like a young actress playing her, but all physically toned and tight.
Oh, yeah.
And then there's just an Ike Turner actor there
that's just the best
Broadway actor that played a man that tormented her. This man, tormented her, and this guy's like, hi, Tina, how are you? And she's like, get away from me, Ike. And he's like, sorry, my name's LeVar. I'm actually playing Ike Turner.
Yeah, it's what's funny about the documentary also is it's yet again another 2-hour story of her dealing with Ike Turner and getting away from Ike Turner.
Yeah.
Like the movie was about that and her book. She released albums and was huge and toured stadiums. But man, anytime she wasn't singing, it didn't matter how much shit she got. They always want to go, like, we should make a movie about your life. He goes, yeah, but like, just the Ike Turner. What about all the success afterwards? Like, yeah. That's what the guys from Queen were pissed off about the movie. They didn't like the movie Bohemian Rhapsody because they were like, why did it stop when he died? Yeah. It's like, you know why, motherfucker.
You guys know we went on to tour for 6 weeks. Like, shut up.
I mean, really, they're like, you know, we still tour actively now. He goes, yeah. Yeah, why don't we get Adam Lambert to play Adam Lambert in this one?
Do you think they ever pitched Tina a movie, a non-Ike Turner bio? Or she ever pitched that? And everyone's like,
just her being an unpleasant person at restaurants because she's so wealthy for so long?
Yeah. She goes, you know what I really want to tell is the last 20 years with my husband who's 20 years younger than me, my little pool boy Spaniard that I got.
Does it have to be so cold in this restaurant? We're paying good money. Oh, fuck. Tina Turner's here again with her stupid British husband. Fucking... Oh, if the water room temperature, I can't fucking stand these two.
Dude, that's all it
is. Lyle, I spend a lot of money here, Lyle. Please turn off the air conditioning. It's blowing right on my shoulders.
I told you I don't need another hero. I do need a waiter that pays attention. Now follow me through the orders.
Yeah, that was the one thing you don't realize if you get super famous enough for them to do a Broadway play, you have to watch some Broadway actor run over to you as a young version of you and be like, "Hi, Dan Soder, follow me. Do you like this Queens of the Stone Age shirt? Costumes had it made back there."
Young Dan, voice, the Danny Soder story, the musical.
Deep voice, big heart. Anyways, it's been an honor to play you, Mr. Soder. Do you want to hear my song called Aurora? Aurora.
Cyndi Lauper hasn't had a life story yet, right? She hasn't had a life story, has she?
I don't know.
Dude,
what
so
would the
funny.
Big J one be called?
Dude, the Cyndi Lauper one would be great because you get the young her with all the wacky colors in her hair. Then somehow they're going to have to incorporate a Broadway something of her involvement in wrestling.
Oh, dude.
I'm Captain Lou Albano, and I am here to be a father figure in your life and your music videos.
And then she's going to be like,
why don't we bridge them both together? Why don't we have wrestling and rock and roll? Isn't that a good idea, Holster?
That's a fantastic idea, brother. Yeah. I gotta brothers tell you, brother.
Brothers and sisters and brothers, we're gonna wrestle.
We're all brothers. Everyone is brothers. Even though we're from different mothers, you're my brothers.
Now flex.
Hey, I'm Junkyard Dog, the jizzle to the unizzle, kizzle.
Rowdy Piper, Rowdy Piper. I'm Rowdy and I'm Roddy and I'm here to play my pipes.
I'm Superfly Snooka and there's a strong chance I killed my wife.
Smashed her head like a coconut on my head, Rowdy Piper, back again.
I'm Lex Luger. I'm so down. I'm living here without the use of my legs. I used to be super in shape.
Well, that just takes a dark turn when we break.
Now I'm Lex Luger.
You sound more like Craig Glazer.
Like, hey, it's me, Lex Luger. Me and my dogs.
Me and my dogs.
Me, well, Black Barbie, the wheelchair.
I watched it, and you know, you're right. It was a good documentary. And Ike Turner at the end, there was a part where they were like, you know, he got arrested for cocaine as she was doing an interview. And she's just like, oh, no shit. That's such a weird part where they're like, Tina super loved the new album. Did you hear Ike got popped for coke in New York? And she's like, no, I didn't.
Yeah. Okay. Well, here's the part of it where I was saying, Christine, like, I don't understand her perspectives or how any of these things in her life possibly it happened, because I was like, at one point in the documentary, Tina Turner goes, like, people are always going to say, why'd you stay? Why'd you stay through that horrible, vicious, vicious abuse? And she was like, why'd you stay? And I just, like, said out loud, I was like, money, total fear, or it just wasn't as bad as you say it was. It's going to be one of those three, probably. And then I was like, yeah, it's so funny. Like, for all my things, I don't really know a friend or a couple or... I guess I know some girls who say they were in abusive relationships, but I never, again, I know your buddies never be like, hey, dude, I'm pretty abusive to my chick. But like,
man, when I shut the door, it is a problem.
But I feel like
her.
My close friends this long, my close friends, I would know if someone's like a viciously abusive, physically,
well,
for sure. But wait,
I like to test real quick. I like to test by flinching at all my friends' girlfriends. And if they flinch, I go, what's going on?
This bitch ain't worried about nothing. This chick ain't worried about nothing. This dinner's gonna be cold.
How about the ending, though?
Well, hold on. Jay was saying about his. You were saying about his, your abuse. Oh, yeah. You would know at this point if any of your friends.
Well, yeah. If my other were viciously physically abusive, you would know this, right? My assumption would be, and with her going through, and Christine was like, she goes, "No, I was never like in an abusive relationship," but she was like. But I had friends. There were one guy would do this to this girl. Used to be this girl, and I was like, "Well, how old were these people?" And it was like 15 and 19. I'm like, "It's getting physically abusive." Like, that's such a weird. Like, I definitely know there was no physical abusive relationships in my high school. There was none, for sure. Physical abuse in high school? Like, what girls,
if
like...
What
guy's beating his girlfriend in high school?
Man, that what a
angry men without mothers, fathers.
Yeah, I guess. I'm not saying it's an impossibility. I'm just saying,
where
the fuck?
I'm probably sure. I bet it would blow our mind how much more it is than we think. Because if you're in high school and you're just like, why'd you freak out? Why'd you freak out, Corey? Well, that geography test. And then Ashley just wouldn't shut it. So I had to shut it for her. And you're like, you're 15.
I was not from a secluded, sheltered place where I grew up at all. And that's what I was saying. I said, Christine, I'm like, in this same age time, I was like, the guy was wildly abusive to her. She was 15. And I'm like, really? She goes, yeah, well, it was when they got involved with those Nazi guys. Like the Nazi guys, the abusive relationships. I go, there were some kids in my school that maybe robbed some stuff, like broke in and shoplifted, and some cigarette smokers, and I'm sure some pot smokers. Nobody was a Nazi or in abusive relationships with Nazis.
You remember that kid sophomore year that was into human trafficking?
Christine's always like, she goes, and then we go there, and the guy's laying down with a shotgun in the thing. I'm like, what the fuck are you talking about?
Christine went to a 21 Jump Street high school.
Yeah, no shit.
I think she went to Lincoln.
But then when you're like, your high school didn't have self-cleaning sod fields, because ours did, in between the laying down with shotguns and Nazi contingent, we were able to really have some nice fields and grounds to play. And the other one that got me was, and this is just great fodder, Sal Volcano loves things like this, so it's always fun to bring them up. Me and Christine were talking about just like whatever it is about buying houses in general or not with us necessarily, but I was like, yeah, I'm unlike you. Christine's always talking about property and getting property and whatever. And I'm like, yeah, I only want to buy property that I'm going to live in. I don't want to be somebody else's landlord or something like that. And she goes, no, I know, but I just know it's like the best investment turnover for your thing. And she goes, and I'm fine with all these things she was saying. And so she goes, yeah, no, I'm going to make a ton of money in real estate because it comes second nature to me. It's totally second nature to me. And I went, oh, man. I just knew at that point, I was like, this rest of this night's going to be
no
good,
Jay has
no
respect for the fact that I grew up with Armenian realtors in Los Angeles as my uncles and was
that's like wrestling bears in Russia.
I mean, like, Hootie, it's like you have no respect for who I was before you knew me. You're like, when did you work in real estate? I'm like, my whole life in my uncle's office. He gets mad at me if I can't do percentages.
Then you kick off work and have a nasty drug addiction and go blow Nazis. Okay.
Yeah,
you got a lot
died,
in.
Jay. It was a hard time in high school.
I'm not arguing that. I'm saying, for one thing you were not doing good at while you were doing drugs and fucking with Nazis is learning the real estate game ins and outs.
Well, guess what,
Jay? That was for 2 years. What about the years before that and after that I wasn't on drugs?
Also, Jay, I know for a fact that Christine got a Nazi a great deal on a two-bedroom, two-bath at Sunset Market Value. Right.
I've sucked way more black dick than Nazi dick, I can tell you that. Don't tell my uncles that.
I would argue, if you bring up real estate right now without a cheat sheet, no one else
do you guys
can do
want
it.
Real,
if
you guys if want you to have real estate
if you just brought, up real estate, the fucking acronyms, anything else, just take the acronyms of that stuff. I bet she can tell you not even close to all of what they mean, and then also can't tell you what after she doesn't know what the words mean, she doesn't know what the actual thing is.
I can tell you that $2,000 a month investment over the course of 10 years can make you $400,000 if you do it correctly and you have perfect credit like this guy. I know that.
Do you know, Dan, a dollar can turn to $1 million if it moves the right direction?
Jay thinks making money is difficult. It's not that difficult. You just need a little capital, and finally I'm out of survival mode and might be able to make some investments. I don't know why it's so wild to think about. Honestly don't.
You're a real estate mogul. It's not wild to think about, Christine. What I'm saying is you and Lewis have it. You and Lewis J. Gomez have the same
exact
quality. No, there's no you're welcome. This means nothing to me. I'm saying to you, it's such a bizarre thing to come in and be like, yeah, I was around weightlifting a lot when I was younger. If you were like, yeah, Jay
you
knows
know about
the
weightlifting.
Ins. No, I don't know the ins.
You
I'm
know
just
the
saying,
basics?
I know Jay's second nature is deadlifts and power clean.
Second nature, dude. It's second nature to me. That's what I'm saying. It's just
it's
the
what
definitive,
I'd be doing
I
if I didn't
this.
Move to New York to follow my dreams. I would be rich off of real estate already in Los Angeles and make a business.
Hell yeah, you would. For without a doubt.
Dude, alternative
doubt, Jay. I'd be staging for all the men. They don't know how to decorate. I would have taken over that part of the business.
Thankfully, you're the only girl who's ever thought of it, I guess.
alternative universe, Christine, being on every bench in real estate is great. Christine, would you have started as a real estate agent? Because usually that's pastures for
No, dude, that's fucking, that's shit for peons, dude. She's going right in, dude. High-powered real estate mogul.
If I had gone into working with my uncles, I'd imagine I would do like what Jerry Kimowitz does at the dentist office, where she just kind of like runs the ship, even though she's not an actual dentist. She's the one that actually formed the business with her husband and handles that side of things, even though her son and her husband run the actual mechanics of dentistry. So I imagine I would have stepped into that type of role, given the moms and grandmothers are all dead.
Come to Evans Hotel and Casino, where everyone's like family. we're
this is the Vardavidian side, not the Evans side.
Where hospitality comes second nature.
My friend, sit down with Christine, our most trusted real estate agent, and understand that what you are buying is not simply a house, but an investment for years to come.
Christine's ready, man. Just get a yellow blazer and get at it, yo.
Dude, I say just fucking get out there, dude.
Why not?
Christine, to be a realtor. I want to make money off of property.
I understand. I'll be your capital. Let's figure it out from there. Let's invest. I'll be your capital. And
how
then
much
you're going to make.
What can I have? Dude, shit, I didn't know I could have capital. You have capital?
Oh, dude, we totally. But I need my investment back in less than a year.
Hold it for
a week.
That's
not how this works. So never mind. Mm. I don't need your investment. I'll figure it out on my own.
Wow. Okay. Cutting loose. Guys, Christine is a free agent in the real estate game.
When do these investment meetings start? Should I be home or should I not be home for them?
You don't need to worry about it.
Jay walks in and there's just seven strangers there being like, okay, so what are we investing in? And she's like, the bonfire. It's just all a Ponzi scheme. You give me 100 and then we'll buy property.
I know what she does. Angel Rodriguez, B-Rod's husband, said the sentence a couple weeks ago, like, oh, you should invest in yourself. You should buy stock in Sirius. And that has been Christine's mantra ever since. Like, it was something that was passed down to her from the heavens one
day.
Somebody
super smart that on a sword. Knows business.
Went, I'm not arguing that. I'm just saying.
Lunch with him one day. At lunch with her one day, she was going,
you think I don't want to learn the Tina Turner Buddhist chant to get back with the oneness?
That wasn't the Buddhist chant, because that was Wolf of Wall Street there, fucking real estate mogul. I think you actually know a financier, huh?
Yeah. Also, Jay, if she gets into Buddhist chants, just get ready for a brawl in a car.
Oh, no. She can get into Buddhist chants if she wants.
And then on the way to the Moon Tower shows, she's going to fucking just you two scrapping in the back. I told you I'll sell it. I'll be a real estate mogul.
Do you know the beauty of a chick is that my money has to be for the group situation, and Christine's talking about all her future ventures that she's able to do now because I take care of everything.
I said I'd split expenses down the middle before I started investing, if that's what you want.
Yeah, that's what I want.
Dude, I'm for it. I'm for coming over.
When are these investments going to start? I hope I don't slow it down too much.
Come
over. I don't want to impede your mogul.
She's got a Bloomberg station and five screens going. And she's like, you're going to shit, Jay. The market in China just ducked on me. So anyways. Yeah.
Fuck you. I'm leaving you. Sugar just went up.
I'd really love for you to understand that I'm not in love with you for your money at all. So if I had like my own money and wasn't dependent on you in that way at all, maybe you'd like finally realize that like the lifestyle is not what I'm in this for.
Well, baby,
at least not
that
the financial
is imminent.
Lifestyle.
That is imminent because this world is a real estate playground and you are getting ready to fucking dip your toes in that fucking sand pot. I'm so excited for you. I can't believe this is happening.
Man,
$1 million listing.
Fast forward to 2 years from now, and we're pushing cameos on here to be like, so listen, we invested in Christine in some things that went south, and
no, Dan, do not invest. Nobody here can invest. She's going to get external investors, she said. Unless DJ Lou. DJ Lou, you want to dive in there? I say you could dive in there.
Seems legit to me.
Yeah,
this is
right. Real estate second nature to Christine because she said it is.
Yeah.
You know what? Hospitality is more second nature than real estate. Real estate might be like fifth nature.
What?
We provided you with an investor and you just backpedled.
Hospitality.
You were on his way to making Lou the kingpin of TNIC with all your financial buy-ups.
I thought I was a real estate mogul. I thought I was a real estate mogul. Turns out I'm a front desk girl.
Dude, I could always open my little store in Monterey.
Dude, totally. When you get your fucking Santa Barbara ranch. I heard the whole story yesterday. I let you jarble your nonsense, and then I save it all for these moments. So I can point out to everybody else in front of you how moronic you are and that you need help and some sort of medication. You ramble nonsense constantly.
You will not medicate me. I'm fucking fine.
I'll never medicate you. It's not me.
Lou, there's another one, Lou. You will not medicate me. I am fucking fine.
Jay, can I say that you might be being a little hard on her, and I'd like to lighten the mood with a little theme song for her?
Sure. Okay.
Yeah, dude. All right. Forget.
No, not feeling it, Lou.
Come
on.
I'll
tell you why. No, I'm going to give the full disclosure here. I was going to do a bit. This is how difficult Christine is to like. I had this bit planned before we came back on the air.
Once you got to know me.
Before we came back on the air, even, didn't have the deal finished yet. I said a funny thing would be, I give Christine, it looks to everybody like I give Christine such a hard time because they don't know what fucking lunacy is happening around me at all times. She turns her cameras on early enough that now the staff all is aware and terrified of Christine's fucking tornado-ish personality and how the insane thing she blabbers out. We could all tell when she's going through something. She starts saying insane shit on the radio. Great for radio.
But it turns out that you're Tina and she's Ike when this whole time we thought she was Tina.
Buddy, abso-fucking-lutely, she is Ike.
We got to get you Buddhist chant.
That's what she does. Dance, monkey. Go out there and fucking sing funny songs for everybody. And I'll sit back here and live in an apartment and be a see you next Tuesday 95% of the time.
You know what, Jay?
And then talk to you and brag to you about our real estate mode. Good, I'm glad that I fucking work so hard and travel around.
Fuck me more. I'll be less of a cunt.
No, there's nothing less attractive to fuck than a fucking lady telling you about all the
fuck
money
the cunt
she's
right
make.
Out of me, dude.
That's a really good one.
No. These aren't turn-on words.
It's what works. It's the thing that works. You want me to be less of a bitch? Fuck me more often. That's how we work.
Oh, well, why don't you fuck somebody with a bigger dick and really chill out? I mean, good Lord. It's, yeah. But you guys are seeing it. But the people at home, they really do. The narrative will be that I'm saying crazy shit. But Christine, I asked her 7 times during this conversation about her real estate moguling. I go, I believe you. You're going to own this city like Trump. Can we please? I'm so bored of this conversation. I don't want to hear about it. She goes, no, but you don't understand. It's like, if you buy a guy that I know who knew my uncle one time, who met him, who was a neighbor of his that was a billionaire, said that if you buy a hotel, you can't go wrong. It was when Todd Lynn got money, spent it all on refurbishing his rental apartment, bought a car outright in cash, and then told me he was going to open a Subway franchise. It's boobish thinking with a very determined fucking tone.
Sorry, am I renovating a rental right now, or am I talking about investing in something that could make me money one day instead of buying expensive bags?
With fictitious cash. That's the point I'm making.
And that's why we have talked about it on this episode. Campers, get in ground level. We are going to GoFundMe. Pour it in.
To get Christine some capital?
You could be Christine's capital.
Oh, absolutely.
Flood it.
Christine's going to Shark Tank her idea. And by the way, it's the first Shark Tank ever. They go, what's the product you're trying to sell? She goes, me. I want Mark Cuban. Just give me money and let me do real estate stuff because that's second nature to me. I know basketball ownership is probably second nature to you. Let me handle the real estate because I've never bought anything in real estate.
Surprisingly, Christine bought the Minnesota Timberwolves and took them to the top of the league.
2 apartments ago, I was sleeping on a floor behind a couch.
You're probably wondering, how did it all start? And the answer is easy. Here, in my own head. Welcome to Second Nature, the Christine Marie Evans biography.
But Dan, as dude to dude, you're bro to bro.
Yeah.
And Christine just as another person.
Weenie to weenie.
She rolled her eyes at bro to bro.
Weenie to weenie.
You have to understand, working a bunch and running all over the place and the schedule that I have to keep to make money now, hearing someone talk about their lifty, lofty fucking future way that maybe they're going to make some money to add on one day after she just costs a lot of money herself is just immoronic, and you're trying to stop an argument because you're going like, I don't want to, I'm so bored of this conversation, I don't want to talk about it. She goes, no, let me tell you, hang on, I'm Christine from Remax, and I want to tell you, if you make a series of small investments.
You've had investment money for a while now, longer than me. You have, probably for the last 5 years, and you've done nothing with it. Like, you haven't done any investment. You haven't done anything with you. So I'm like, you don't seem to be interested in that. I want to create wealth so I can do charitable stuff, and I can do, like, you don't seem interested in, like, stock options or real estate or, like, any of that. So I'm like, it is a conversation just with someone else.
At any moment, I expect Luis J. Gomez to walk from side camera with a Madonna mic on. And like, thanks for bringing that up, Christine. There's a lot of different examples where I could show you where you could put your capital.
With my 83-point plan.
I mean, yeah. Me and Luis own business together. Like, we have... Like, that could possibly sell one day.
Fuck yeah, it could. Christine's going to take an investment from a 1,000-person festival. She took that investment, and now she is the owner of Mar-a-Lago. But she's changing things a little bit. There's going to be more pentagrams and Wiccan shit.
But is everything golden in this real estate mogul's life? We've recently interviewed a man who purchased Skankfest. I was just a fan of Luis J. Gomez's, and then I wanted to buy Skankfest, and it was just like three empty solo cups, and then like I had to pay the staff fare on a rented out venue.
I don't have a job, but Christine just took me on her word that I'll pay her monthly for some reason. So I'm the owner. Title's in my name.
Now it's Mark's Skankfest.
And then Christine's going to be home laughing at me. She goes, CJ sold Skankfest. This guy's going to give me, he promised me $1,000,000,000 a month. And I'm prepared to believe him. He was wearing a Misfits t-shirt.
I have a kajillion dollars.
Now you feel stupid. Now, if you could do me a favor, Jake, can you buy dinner tonight? Because my kajillion hasn't hit my account yet. It must be a Venmo thing.
Turns out my kajillion hasn't gone liquid yet. So. If you could just front me.
Sorry to say, Mike. Looks like, hang on, I'm checking again real quick right now. No, Gajillion hasn't come through yet. It doesn't even say pending, weirdly enough, but this guy promises to Venmo me. I gave him my number and everything.
I think it's a weird Dutch bank.
No, I think it's coming from overseas, so it might be, he said like five to seven business days.
I gave him the right routing number, that's for sure. I said it twice.
So do you have money for Juul cartridges? Because even though I'm a bajillionaire. I'm just not the second, okay? But on spec, I am. So front me. Front me.
I don't think I should follow your lead on this. I don't.
On real estate?
Dude, what? This
on
is finance.
What?
I didn't realize this episode was going to be our financial roast.
Damn, son.
I can see Jacob's here. Jacob's idea of a good time is a 401k rolled into an IRA.
This motherfucker's sitting around eating or riding tater tots. Never invest in the company, you dumbass motherfucker. You keeping him in business. Christine, I would suggest, yes, you know what? That's the first smart real estate move you said so far. Do not take my lead on this. That is good, because I will not know what to tell you, because I don't know what MSRP is, and I don't know if that's only cars or if that's also houses.
I think it's engine strength.
Is that horsepower?
I think it's glue strength and engine strength.
Yeah. I only know a few acronyms. IUD. What's up, Dan? Knuckle
What's
me,
up?
Dude.
Boom. If you want a bear back.
Yo, IUD. Yo, don't, that little metal thing better not go on my dick hole. Am I right, Dan?
And then I also know IED. God bless. Thank you for your service.
God bless. Thank you all for your service.
I also know about a little BBW.
Are you pointing at me? I'm not a BBW.
No, I was pointing at Jacob. We're in that group together, that Facebook group.
But yeah, do not follow my lead, and go have at it. I'll go eat at fucking Evans Hotel and Restaurant.
Thanks. It means a lot that I have such a strong man that you don't mind if I go off and become successful in my
own. No. I want you to save me a table for me and my non-lunatic new girlfriend who we'll be coming in with. You wouldn't house us. We're not sticking to stay friends after this.
You can hang out with me and my non-lunatic girlfriend, too.
Who's
I'm not dating because I'm
Christine,
such a fancy lesbo.
I'm gonna visit you until you get out of the fucking girl interrupted hospital you're going to have to be at when they fucking when you finally crack and fucking do something wacky on a roof. Why is everyone laughing, Christine? Because they're watching you unravel, and you're not recognizing it.
They watch Jay. Me unravel yearly. I ravel back together. It's fine. We've done some cool shit in, with my manic and depressive times.
Yeah, I'll tell you what we haven't done. Made money in the market or real estate.
Well, whose fault is that?
You have things you need to take care of before we can start investing in things together.
You can invest in whatever you want to invest in. Why haven't you invested?
I'm excited. Christine, I think you should put together a whole PowerPoint presentation to get Jay on board and invest in.
Yeah, where's her
dossier? There's just conversations where I'm like, this is why it's important to have friends and not just be in your relationship, because it's like people that are great for these conversations, Luis J. Gomez, Ari Shaffir. I could say it. We talk business. We talk investment. They go. They give a shit about
Yo,
it.
Yo, those guys
Jay
are fantastic
just does not
with money.
Care. He just doesn't care.
Christine, those two people are fantastic with money. Do you mean jungle for 6 months with no making money while he runs a company, Ari Shaffir? Or are you talking about Luis, 7 vacations a fucking year and buys everyone their tickets
Luis,
to Big
Dick?
Luis,
who owns multiple businesses and multiple shows. And bro, like, I don't know why we're acting like these aren't people to be impressed by.
No, no, you could be impressed with them for their thing. I'm just saying financial advice from these people.
I'm just saying when it comes to investment, vision, and ideas, it's not you to have the conversation with. It's like we have it and hope you come along for the ride.
No. Investment, yeah. Not investment in what you're saying.
I think.
Well, I've been investing in you for years, buddy.
You've put not $1 into me.
It's an NRP. What are those things called? One of those.
What's
things?
An NRP, Christine?
No, it's not an NRP.
No idea.
NPR. What is, you guys know
MSRP, what's an NPR? Manufacturer suggested retail price. Is that what you mean?
No, it's a new
thing.
She
looks like a young BD Wong.
Exactly. It's a new form of currency that fucking the kids are talking about.
Christine just read MSRP.
Oh, crypto? I did.
Of course you did. You're sitting in front of a computer. You're the person who looks things up. But thanks for letting me.
I'd argue that part of my job is looking up black dick.
Go back to that. Stick to black dick and stay away from skyscrapers and real estate.
Oh, you love that.
Yeah, if you talk about black dick instead of boring the shit out of me with fucking your real estate promises.
I'll talk about I can't even say what I was going to say because it was going to get pulled as a drop, and I'm glad I caught myself on that one.
I mean, we already got some good drops, so
yeah,
we're all good.
Have no fear. Every day you talk, you just give some layups of insanity.
I'm crazy
you are good
about
for radio.
Lines.
You are good for radio. The other 22 hours is what the concern is. I just talked about this on Skanks, but a little thing. Did you see, I know we got to take a break soon anyway, but have you, see Donnell Rawlings fucking walked off of Kill Tony?
No.
For what?
Really?
Yeah, he walked off. I think he was hammered. And like, Donnell said, said it on Skanks too. He's fucking hilarious. Such a hilarious comic. I don't know if it's a drinking issue or what, cause he has so much TMZ shit with like drinking with him, but he fucking on Kill Tony, like, he was kind of ball busting one of the comics, and then the comic just like started roasting him back.
Yeah.
And they were going back and forth, and Donnell just wasn't quick. He was like, you know, he's just hammered. So he was like off. And then he gave like a 7-minute speech, like took the stage and stood up, like from sitting down on Kill Tony, and like talked in the front of the stage, kept saying it wasn't a funny, this is a serious story about, I don't know. It was so long and went no, and then he just walked off the show eventually. Never came back. Yeah, so weird. But, I mean, a great watch. I always say for that, it's a great watch. If you like seeing things unravel, it's a good one. Yeah, you don't
have to play it. Oh, so it's up on YouTube.
It's up on YouTube.
Yeah, man, that's just got to be a thing where, like, when someone walks off the energy of Kill Tony, how do you go back to that? Where you're like, all right, the next guy coming up.
Oh, dude, they really
Lawson.
Do that.
And then it's just like, hey, yeah. If you're a comic, that show's already hard. If you're trying to do stand-up on it, doing stand-up on it after one of the people walked off is fucking real hard.
Should we take our first break? This went 40 minutes somehow.
Well, I'll tell you what we learned in those 40 minutes is that I'm dumping all my excess capital into Marie Evans equity.
Oh, CME Industries?
I'm looking forward to owning a lot of land, a lot of capital, a lot of money.
You got it.
Buying that $3 million property in Montana.
My point is, and it all comes back to this is the actual point. I said, since everybody says I go with Christine on our old channel, it would be funny this time as I say I've turned a new leaf and I'm trying to go easier on Christine. So if I ever start getting wound up from her insanity and nonsense that Lou would play this song, Beta Rock, She's So High, Tal Bachman, and I would, and then the sketch essentially would be me going like, okay, nope, try to keep cool. She didn't have one moment of the show where I felt where this bit would have worked. Every time she did, I was like, no, don't play the song. I have to correct the batshit thing she's saying right now. It's lunacy. So, Christine, go back in your get in your crate for the commercial break. And I don't want you to bite in the fucking chairs. And we'll be right back. We got a lot of fun stuff to talk about today. It's the Bonfire.
And now, back to the Bonfire with Big J. Okerson and Dan Soder.
So bummed to miss that concert. So bummed.
Good one. That was a good one.
Really
that
bummed.
Was a good one. I mean, right down, we were walking out. Christine looked around. She goes, might buy this place. If I just had a little capital, I'd turn this bitch around so quick.
She goes, I'd turn this into a two-bedroom. And you go, it's Radio City.
Yeah, this is, it's, what was it? Gramercy. That's the Gramercy Theater. And you go, yeah, now. I see a lot of potential in this place.
Probably a studio. Turn it into a studio.
Right, there's going to be a studio. Everything's going to become a yoga studio.
Yeah, turn this thing into a yoga studio. Make some real money.
Right, there's going to be a yoga studio pretty quick. Turn it around.
Welcome back to the Bonfire on Faction Talk, Sirius XM 103. Don't need to do that. Just felt like doing it.
Yeah. You play by your rules.
Dude, I play by my rules. Dude, I saw a news story today that I was like, usually when the teacher sex thing comes up, mm-hmm. You're usually like, you know, if it's a lady, you're like, well, what's going on? You know, it's a double standard, but we have it.
Totally. Are you saying if it's a girl? Yeah, it's the South Park, right? Nice.
Yeah, nice. What do you want me to do? Track this little boy down and give him the luckiest boy in the world award? that's my favorite line. But there's one today that came out that I was like, no, this is disgusting. This is a disgusting. Christina, send it to you in the chat.
As soon as it becomes a dude, right?
No, it's a woman and it's gross.
What?
It's a woman and it's surprisingly like I would be if I were a parent of this child, I would be very upset.
No matter what. Looks mean nothing in this story. Yeah, how old your son? It's your son.
Well,
how old is he?
That's the problem.
That's the whole point.
That's the point. It was a second grade class and the teacher was arrested after she was caught masturbating in the class with a room full of kids.
Second grade? I got my tonsils out in second grade, so I remember second grade to some degree.
I'll tell you right now, if Mr. Owens was just jacking it right there while I was reading my fucking Disney adventures, I think I'd freak out.
It's different, though, and I don't even know why. It just is completely different. I would have totally liked in second grade to see this lady flicking her bean, for sure.
She's got softball catcher face.
Yeah, without a doubt. But here's what she probably doesn't have. A fupa, really. I could tell by her neck. This girl's all right.
She's 30 years old.
Yeah.
It says a Georgia substitute. You're a substitute. And you're like, what are you going to do? You're like, I don't know, go into some class I don't care about. Fucking
dude,
bean.
You have one school day to fucking make an imprint, dude, to really make a difference. And I'm telling you, she stood out.
Before we read this story, a couple things. It's a substitute teacher, so it was a movie. Do you think there was a Disney movie that got her all juiced up, and that's where she started fucking masturbating? Or she was, like, sexting with someone, and then, you know, during the movie day, and then the guy was like, is there a guy behind it? That's what I'm trying to say. Is there a guy that was like, that's so fucking hot, I can't wait to fuck you later. I wish you didn't have to substitute teach for that stupid, those stupid kids.
I gotta...
Not right there, she filmed it, so it, I bet she was doing it for an OnlyFans or something. It's like, that's a kink.
In front of kids?
I mean, people are into just like getting away with it, like one of those type things. I'm not saying I'm into it. I'm saying that's probably what it was done for.
I got to tell you, by the way, I'm super into it. I would jerk off to that video we're talking about right now forever.
Really? You hear Raffy in the background and she's just like...
Yeah, what a piece of garbage she is doing that, right? It's so hot.
Baby, what trash.
Isn't that considered underage? Like, isn't that underage? Child?
Jacob, maybe she should go to prison. I'm saying I want to see the video of her beating it in front of her fucking kids in second grade.
Yeah. Okay.
I don't know why.
They're saying in the article that the kids could have seen her touch herself, but they didn't say they did see her touch herself.
Fucking this. It says, only the lucky ones, Dan. Only the lucky ones.
Only the little boys that grew up that day.
Oh, man.
He goes, I'll tell you exactly where I was when my nuts dropped. I was in Miss Wrestler's class. We were watching 3-2-1 Contact, and I turned around and saw her just hamming herself.
What if they go, you'll never teach again? She goes, I never taught before. I just signed up for this so I could do my OnlyFans in here. Yeah.
She goes, teaching degree. She goes, you should have checked in on it. That was a copy of my friends with my name over their name. You guys didn't do a background check. Yeah. I'm not really a teacher. I'm a freak.
Now, if you don't mind me, I have to go shit on the steps of the public library for this one guy in Houston.
I got to go ask a guy who works at Subway to spit in my mouth while he makes a sandwich.
I got to jam out.
I'd love to stick around, but I got a boogie. I got some sick, depraved shit to do downtown.
Are we not finding out who said that they saw her filming this act?
Well,
here's my question. This also... could be completely made up.
Well, let's get to the quotes. It says...
He condemning right away, because if she did it, she's a piece of shit. But what if... Dude. I mean, just Dan, you're substitute teaching, right?
Yeah.
And just say you have your phone out and you're... Sure. Let's say you're... I'm just making a scenario. You're looking at yourself in your camera because you're making sure there's nothing in your teeth before you teach a class, right?
Got it.
And right before they come in, like, you don't even hear the door open just quite yet, is when you're turning around and you're fucking knocking that big, huge, fat, juicy cock ears, like, in the place. It's a little out of place right now. It's coiled up in the front, and you'd like to choose a side, right? So you just knock it over in your pants. But the kid walking in sees you turn around making that move, looking in your phone, they're like, oh, shit, we saw Mr. Soder jacking it. You would have the same exact face in your mugshot. That'd be you. You're okay. Like, fuck, dude, like, I'm going to have to scream this from the fucking rooftops that I'm fucked.
Well, let's get into what the actual video was, because it says here, go down, Christine.
Does she have an OnlyFans is a good way to find out.
That's not what had the...
Keep going.
This is lying here.
Yeah, I know. Keep going down. We get there, right? No, it's moving. No, it's popping back up. And this is... There it is. Detectives began investigating Wrestler after she received a tip about the video. After receiving a tip about the video circulating in the community.
Oh, hell yeah.
Sent to someone. We obtained video evidence because she videoed it herself and decimated it, and we were able to get a hold of that evidence.
No, disseminated it.
Disseminate? I don't know. By the way, shout out to the camper that told me it was NFT was the currency I was looking for earlier in the segment. So, Christine, you can invest in that. That was
the point. No, NFT should invest in her.
What? What?
Blow your mind.
Thanks, Reverend.
What was the word? Mm-hmm.
Spread or disperse. Oh, so she pushed it out there.
Oh.
Why didn't she just use...
Got you. So that's how they were able to get a hold of the evidence, because she gave it out. Well, damn. Look her up, Christine. Friday. Let's get to this video.
She was booked into... We appreciate the dedication of the Carroll County schools has for the safety of their students, and we're contacted immediately following allegations, and we will continue to work closely with them during the remainder of the investigation. All right, so it's still under investigation. That video got out there. Someone watched her flicker bean as a bunch of little kids finger painted.
Dude, could you imagine the FOMO if you've overplayed your sickness that morning to not go into school? Could you imagine that? First of all, already you had substitute teacher day, so it wasn't going to be that serious no matter what.
That was always a bummer when you missed school and you found out it was a substitute.
Now your substitute's fucking just punching box while they're doing second grade shit.
Yeah,
learning how to write or whatever.
That's even cooler than extra recess.
Way cooler, for sure.
Okay, you want a little extra time playing kickball, or you want to see? You want to become a man?
Yeah, you're a big dick in me.
Oh. Oh, guys, wait! I have a that's fucking wild. Another funny. Do you guys want another funny Christine thing? This isn't an argument one. This is just funny. Christine said that her family, from my stories that have been on television,
yeah,
just say that they just tell Christine told me today that her family just thinks she dates a bisexual man. And I'm like, what?
That's very funny.
There's zero anything of that.
That is very, very funny to know that all of her family, when you meet them, they're like, hey, so here he is. Here's that flip-flopper.
That's why I don't meet her family. I don't want to this guy side-eyed me the whole time. Going, like,
what's it like? What, doing stand-up? No, being with a man.
What if we find out one of her uncles is bi because he makes a pass at me when Christine's doing something Armenian?
He tries to kiss you as you're trying to get a glass out of the cupboard.
Yo, what's up, hairy dude?
He goes, what? I thought we were going to party. Christine tells me you like to suck and fuck. I got some real estate tips that'll blow your goddamn mind.
Yeah, knock your dick in the dirt. I'll let you get ahead of her in the real estate game. She thinks it is second nature, but we taught her wrong on purpose.
We taught her all the opposite terms.
Buy high, sell low, I tell her. Every year on Christmas card.
Christine, why does your family think Jason is bisexual?
My family is like pretty traditional Armenian, and they just don't understand that group sex is straight. So just the fact that Jay has stories where he's like had sex with a woman with another man, they're like, well, that's gay. Like, there's no gray area to them.
Square.
And they're like, it's bisexual. And I'm like, I tried to explain to them, no, Jay might want to watch a guy like have sex with another girl, but when he sees a guy, he doesn't want to fuck that man or get fucked by that man.
They're like,
I think that's the difference.
I mean, not until a girl shows up.
It's levels of Kinsey scale, I think. And to them, it's like, there's kind of straight. I've had major problems with my Armenian family about my sexuality. I met a new girl like Ani Mush, who's Armenian and works at Gas Digital now. So I became fast friends with her because generally like Armenian girls wouldn't be bisexual working at Gas Digital. So it's been interesting.
They're like, we're fine with bisexuality. Nothing with a real ass dude running it. I don't want you working for a.
That is a big problem.
So I explained to them my side of things and how it's like Kinsey scale and that I don't think that he's bisexual. And like, but
Christine,
I can't.
You said Kinsey scale twice now. You eked it in there and everybody noticed.
Because I think that there are men that would never have sex with another man in the room. And I think that we have to like respect that, like there are different levels of straight.
Right.
Shades of straight.
Shades of straight. They're just like, you know,
I would
or
have
men that wouldn't
guy.
Admit to it.
Yeah. Tell your fucking inbred family that I don't fuck dudes.
But you fuck with dudes.
Tell your fucking
dudes are fucking. That's that.
Tell those fucking Holocaust hillbillies that I don't fuck dudes.
They go, it has been brought to my attention, Jason, that you like the company of a man. Would you like my company, Jason?
If this is the judgment.
It was funny, it was right after the bisexual test thing, too, that I had this conversation. I ended up calling my aunt that I hadn't talked to in a while.
Yo, I'll tell you what. What happened? Did you guys all go to the border and start calling you guys start calling Turkey bisexual because they fucked in the same room as another guy before?
Yeah.
Is that why Turkey fucking moved in and fucked your shit up? You go, these guys are talking crazy shit. They're calling us all gay.
Dude, what? They go, yeah, they say we're gay. Yeah,
they're saying we're all gay because we don't have a lot of different rooms. And like, so we all have to kind of fuck in the same room. But I've never touched you ever, Turkish name.
You know our parties? You know our fun parties? They called us gay for that. Go fight them. Go fight them right now.
Fucking
we
take them out.
Rich standing by, just FYI, at 6:02. I don't know if we want to break or just bring him in.
Just bring him in.
Yeah, he's a parent. Jay, as a parent, I'd like to know Rich's opinion on this second grade substitute teacher. Are you like, Rich seems like a guy that I think would be like, I don't want to watch that video.
What are the odds he's in a car?
Ooh, good call. 2-1 odds.
Like, yeah. Everyone says yes to everything. If I'm going to be in a car, I say no to the thing that they wanted me to do. Even if it's like the last minute I found out I'm going to be in a car at the time, I go, yeah, we got to cancel it another time. I'm not doing this
Here's
in a car.
The test. Is Rich in a car? This is exciting.
Drum roll.
This is pandemic exciting. Is Rich in a car? Is
Just at the link, so it might take a second for him to join.
You said he was standing by.
He is. He's texting me. He wasn't waiting.
He's got his glasses. He's got his glasses readers over his nose. He's going.
Ah, all forefathers came to this country.
Is Rich Voss in a car?
The answer. Coming soon.
Isn't that funny that by stories, my family would think Dave Smith is bisexual, too?
Fuck yeah, dude.
I mean, we're all bisexual in your families.
We're all fucking bi to your fucking judgmental-ass family.
Just because your judgmental family doesn't know how to party.
I'm going to genocide if they keep talking that shit. They're going to call me the genocide.
We got green screen, Rich Voss.
No, I think it's just behind him. Is it green screen? Yeah.
That's not a green screen. That's
supposed to.
That's what we hang up at our stupid, what do you call it? That's live events.
Well, this is joining the show. That's the voice of Rich Voss, who's going to be at the Atlantic City Comedy Club this Friday and Saturday, April 9th and 10th. Get tickets at richvoss.com.
No. You can't get tickets at atlanticcitycomedyclub.com. You
can't get tickets at atlanticcitycomedyclub.com.
Man, Christine, I hope you're better at real estate than you are at putting plugs down the right way.
No, it's not her fault.
Why is it not on your website, Rich? Why can't you get tickets at richvoss.com?
You know what? I'll tell you what. Put on the She's So High song, Lou. I got to be honest with her. Rich, your website should sell your tickets.
What's going on?
First of all, are you selling real estate now, Christine?
Oh, yeah. That was the whole first hour, buddy.
I'm not selling real estate. I'd like to start investing in real estate eventually.
Rich, if you got a couple bucks, dude, she's ready to buy a building right now. She's telling me she can flip it over and turn it and slap it up, flip it, rub it down.
All-time low. Buildings.
Real estate agents put their headshots on park benches. You know who sleeps on park benches? Homeless people. Okay?
Why
don't you just fucking rub it in?
Yeah, that's a good point. Rich, we're going to be passing around a tip bucket if you want to throw some money in for Christine's equity.
Yeah, we're getting some capital for her.
Oh, yeah. For what? Capital for what? For
her. I'll be honest with you. We know, she knows even less than we know. But she's wants us to know that it will come second nature to her to do real estate. It's just in there because her uncle did it and she was at the office once.
Why don't we throw money together for Jay for your COVID cough or whatever the fuck you're dying from?
Well, that's for my respirator, actually, Rich.
Oh, yeah. Listen, Rich, he can only be off the machine for 3 hours a day. So we try to make it look natural.
Please don't make me laugh too hard. I only have a few hours in me.
If he's wheezing, he's running out.
Jay, and I'm not trashing. Why are you dressed like fucking Woody from Toy Story? What the fuck? You know?
It's his mask. It's Cowboy Wednesdays at the Oakerson house.
But I'd rather just pull it down because if I keep taking it off, it's going to mess up my wacky hair.
Oh, if you go outside, that's what you lift up. You wear that as the mask?
Yeah.
Oh, I thought you and Christine were playing like some fucking Roy Rogers or Will Rogers bullshit. I don't know. But no,
Will Rogers?
Well, I don't know. Whoever's the cowboy in there.
Roy Rogers was the cowboy.
No, that was the fucking roast beef restaurant.
Right, but it was also an old West character, Roy Rogers. Right, yeah,
they're both,
Jacob?
Roy Rogers
and Dale Evans.
Yeah.
And Will Rogers was like the comic type guy.
The Will Rogers Institute, I know, but I don't know who Will Rogers is necessarily.
Guys, I want to completely change the subject and talk about Jimmy Dean. Was he ever a cowboy, or did he just make breakfast sausage?
Guys, John Denver, was he gay or a hillbilly?
Guys, I don't mean to zig when you're zagging, but let's talk about the king of sandwich meats, Jimmy Dean.
Whose famous uncle was James Dean, the actor.
Really? That sexy motherfucker gave birth to the, or was the uncle of the Breakfast King?
No, are you fucking kidding me? I just have nothing to say, so I threw that out.
Rich, we were just talking about a story in Georgia where a substitute teacher recorded herself masturbating in a classroom full of second graders and then got caught handing the video out. And Swear to God, it's a real thing. Christine, bring it up. I can't believe Rich wouldn't believe
herself. She filmed herself jilling in class. And then started circulating the video herself.
What?
Rich, if you're a parent of one of those kids, do you watch the video?
Yes.
She already looks like that's a mugshot. I mean, that's probably.
She looks like young Paula Bell.
Oh, wow. Doesn't she look like a hostile female comic?
This is always. She looks like one of those in a night movie where they take off their helmet, and you're like, "You've been a girl this whole time."
I'm telling you, no boy in that class was upset if he saw that. They went over and giggled with other boys, and they were excited. A young girl would be the one that's more like fucking. It's gonna hit him in the guts more.
I mean, does it say what she was reading or what got her going?
We'd have to assume that it was, like I said, a boyfriend or somebody, or I said an OnlyFans thing.
Oh, yeah. God. I mean, if you look,
there's
at
no
the
evidence
size...
except the fact that she put the video out, and I guess you hear kids in the background, which is...
Do you remember when this was like once every 5 years you would hear a story about a teacher fucking a student? And I just saw on the sidebar of that article, and there were six different other stories about, like, this chick got caught on Snapchat. This one had an aide turn on her. And you're like, there's just...
Dude, it's always the dudes just don't get caught, or they really have just been scared out of the game of doing it and maybe they put himself. But every time I talk to
them, or they murder them and it becomes a 2020 documentary.
Dude, every time I meet in an audience, especially a young male teacher, you know, and I ask them what they teach, and if they say ever like fucking high school, I'm just like. Tempted fate, dude. Like, you're just sort of tempting fate. Like, I don't know. It seems like so, like a public high school, like, teacher dude who's, like, young. And it's like, I don't know, man. Like, it's, you feel like you're just setting yourself up to be in a bad situation.
I'm not anti-woman with a wife and three kids. But if you're a student, you're more likely to listen to a male teacher than a female. So what's a better way for the female teacher to get your attention?
Hello. You know, Hello. There's a reason beautiful women work in real estate and at car dealerships. It's to get you.
Man,
in
Joe
the
Clark.
Door.
That'd been funny if Joe Clark never thought of that when he walked into Lean On Me school. If he just got up and started jerking his dick right away, he goes, "Hello, everybody. Everybody, look at this. Look at this. Pay attention to me."
Christine brings up an article that Fox 5 talked to one parent named Nicole, whose daughter was in that second grade class.
Said, "My daughter bitch and moan." Nicole is piss and moan.
Jay, hold on. My daughter had been bragging about the substitute, saying they were having lots of fun. They played lots of games. Yeah, like watch me make your pencil disappear. She's like, "You want to see something fun?" She goes, "Yeah, look at that, huh?" The mom said she actually knows wrestler who lives in Carlton. She graduated about the same time we did. Oh, weird. That's a girl you went to high school with? So it just seems worse. Investigators are talking to the students and parents trying to determine exactly what the children may have seen. It's one of those, it says, it's one of these things the kids are going through that they shouldn't. The mental anguish that's causing these children and parents. That was our drive behind working this case, getting it down quickly, getting it put in jail quickly as possible.
What if the alibi was like this girl coming in, she goes, "No, I've known her since high school. They used to call her Itchy Pussy Kathy." So it's like, yeah, it's a misunderstanding what you think you saw there.
It's all optics. You guys didn't see it right.
You didn't see the whole thing. If it was my son that was in that class, I'd be like, he's fine. If it was my daughter, I'd be a little more concerned for sure. I would act concerned no matter what, but at all of those how do we deal with this meetings, I'm elbowing two or three people who look cool and going, "Did you see the actual video? Did any of you guys see the video at all? Can I see it? Like, what's the big deal? Is it really crazy? Like, should she be fired?"
You started to ask those questions to try to get the video.
I won't show it to anybody either.
You know what? My wife and I were actually laughing about it. We were saying, like, You probably send us the video. We wouldn't care.
It's not even a big deal. He goes, do you mind? Would you actually? I know I can look it on your phone. But would you actually mind sending it to me? So I'm going to show my wife when I get back to the place.
She was a substitute too, right? Maybe she was practicing for, you know, maybe she was headed to the high school.
She's getting called up. She's getting called up to the majors, and she had to get ready. She goes, I got my eye on a junior varsity running back that's going to split me. So I got to start getting ready.
But isn't this a great case?
Huh? Go ahead.
Isn't this a great case also, though, of, like, the headlines big and the retractions? But, like, if this lady goes and they just say it's, like, no, like, a kid made it up and all the kids just kind of went along. This is one of those, like, mob mentality things, and she didn't do that, and there is no video. It's all misunderstanding. Like, there doesn't matter. Like, she'll still never work again because it's always going to be that headline. And then one little article that goes, like, you know what? It turns out one of the kids just made it up.
So, wait, are those second graders? What do second graders don't know about that?
They're about to learn today, Rich Voss.
Jay, it sounds like the video from what these articles say. It sounds like the video was taken maybe for a boyfriend, maybe for an OnlyFans, and it got around the community. Yeah. And then it got to somebody who was like, that's my fucking kid's classroom. And they realized she was there. And so I don't think that she was, like, diddling herself in front of kids. I think she was kind of doing it under the radar, and somebody saw the video and was like, that's my fucking kid's classroom, dude. That's Mount Zion Elementary.
Yeah, because there are art projects in the back when she's fingering herself, and you go,
that's my boy's hand turkey.
Oh, my God, I know that. I know that house and that dog, and I think that's our house. That's our drawing.
But are they mad that she didn't
That's little Eric's hand turkey.
Are they mad that she didn't get a release for that artwork?
Yeah, that's why. They held it up. They go, first off, my son drew that fireman, and
she's making money off that.
It was posted on your OnlyFans. You're at $15 a month.
It's part of the set dressing. High. It's part of the set dressing. It does need to be licensed.
If you're the boyfriend, if you're her boyfriend, and you were just like, it'd be pretty hot if you sent me a video of you fingering yourself at work, and then now this is happening.
She's like, it's national fucking news. And he's like, oh, babe, it was so hot, though. It was so – you still got to be encouraging. You go, babe, but I mean, it was really hot regardless.
95% sure that's what happened.
Yeah.
I know. Big fucking – big price to pay, but, babe, hot.
Babe?
Really, it was hot.
Babe, you always say you care about teaching, and you taught those kids a lot by getting caught. You taught them responsibility. And I think you're overlooking
God,
that.
Dude. That's
but on the other hand, what if she lied to him and said she was working at, like, Baskin Robbins or something?
Yeah, you were a substitute teacher? I would have never fucking asked you that.
Yeah, or what holy if it was, shit.
Or what if it was for her side dick? So she gets caught really like, where are you sending that video? She's like, don't worry about it. It was just for research.
I just want to see if I could.
I was trying to see if I could get away with it.
I thought to myself, like, can I come in front of all these kids?
My agent said send a video.
Yeah.
Oh, I bet she didn't come. I bet it's just like a video of her, like, diddling herself, and then it's, like, real quick.
Oh, you think she says,
like,
that? And you think when it comes up, like, when she tries to object and her lawyer goes, shut up, she goes, I didn't even come.
I barely got wet. What is this about?
She tells the judge, I didn't come here, but know where you're going.
Yeah.
anybody with any common sense in this world doesn't do anything close to that. You know what I mean? I mean, how fucking what's wrong with you that you can even think that that would be semi-okay.
You know, if she would have gone home and masturbated, she would have been like, I almost did it at school. That's how horny I was today. I was teaching because Mrs. Rosenberg's kids were watching a movie, and I almost just did it right there.
Do you think it's an all-around desensitization to the thing? Like, is that what it is? Like, it's just like,
yeah,
we're just kind of there because, like,
I don't think it even crossed. She's like, I'm creating porn in front of children. It, like, probably didn't even cross her mind.
Like, that's what I'm saying. It's like, I don't think she's like, they can't all just be lunatic sociopaths. There's got to be people that when you spell it out for them, like, you just did this, this, and then you go, man, huh? Yeah, that's for sure. Because I know the kids couldn't see me pulling my pussy out, but, like, my pussy was out in this room of children.
They give her the George W. Bush whisper as they tell her. They go, you were filming your pussy in front of a bunch of children. And she goes,
say what?
See, it does fuck up kids, because when Norton was in second grade, his gym teacher shot a load in his face. And
Jesus. Yeah, but all right, but yeah, Rich, I was going to say that's the difference in like that's the difference in going to the zoo and fighting a bear.
That was a good commercial, by the way. When you said that, I swear to you, I didn't know, and I was like, I got to read that book.
Yeah. No. I'm Amazoning it right now.
God damn, it took a load on the face.
Took a load
right on the chops at 5 years old.
No meaning a dodgeball.
Yeah, he's like, yeah. I didn't care for second grade.
I don't know. Like, if one of my daughters was in that class, or my daughter, I would be so pissed, and I would have to get, you know, free lunch for a marking period.
I get that, and I like the way you play that, because honestly, a lot of people probably would go high and try to sue the school district.
No.
But you're just getting your kid a free meal every
day.
No,
keep it local. I don't want to see any chocolate milk bills, and don't give her that bullshit that's wrapped in the tin foil. I mean the fresh stuff, the pizza, and the tacos.
We're talking about the square pizza and a straw hat if you make one.
Top shelf, please.
And she's allowed to take home three of those soft oatmeal cookies.
I don't mean, you know, if I were your legal counsel, I would also recommend some of those fresh rolls, because from whatever those rolls are, sweet Jesus.
Christine, was it you that said you had a fast food in your school? Is that still exist? There's no way that's still a thing, right?
I had, when I was in middle school and high school, you could buy regular school lunch, but then there was also like quarter pounders with cheese and Chick-fil-A sandwiches.
Out of here.
Yeah, but it wasn't, you couldn't get like variant.
Were they pre-made, like, or were they making a Chick-fil-A there?
No, they were pre-made.
I'm not talking about what you're saying. Then what you're saying is different. Even that they got that stuff sent in. I'm talking about
it was there's sent some in, high school. That's why the Chick-fil-A was awesome, because it was a Chick-fil-A sandwich that was just made earlier.
But there's high schools that have like a counter for like a fucking Taco Bell, I think.
When I was in college, we had stuff in the student union. We had like a Panda Express and a McDonald's, but like
my school had a Macy's in the hallway.
Oh, that's crazy! Mine had a Dillard's. It was so different. It was, you know, same kind of style, but yeah, we had a school store that you could steal from for weed money.
Oh, Christine, did we lose you? Did you look this up at all? Fast food
investing
in schools. Where do you go?
I'm sorry, I was updating something on our Instagram.
Yeah. The whole job.
Which makes more money, listing or closing?
Yeah, I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if one of those high schools in like California, like Christine went to, like an LA high school, has a
that
fucking
has fast
McDonald's.
Food in a. It's gotta
we
be like
have, we would have like pizza day, and I feel like maybe at one point Burger King was coming in on Fridays, but
what do you mean coming in? The King himself?
Yeah, dude.
I just
King
feel like
show
one day
career
they would
day.
Have Whoppers.
Yeah, he's like, hello, Nazis and woman beaters and future real estate moguls. It's me, the King.
Hi, Mature Crime High School. I'm Burger King.
This is an article from the Wall Street Journal in 1997 where it talks about the rise of fast food.
Yeah. That was when I was in high school. Shout out Smoky Hill.
They got to be done right now.
13%.
A Taco Bell burrito station and Arby's roast beef. Man,
yeah,
tell you
dude,
what.
I would have loved some Arby's roast
dude,
beef in high school.
I would have wrecked Arby's every day, and I would have eaten at different tables every day with different groups of friends to be like, hey, I figured I'd just fucking do Arby's today instead of the salad, you know? I'm doing good the rest of the week.
I used to go to school just to go to the lunchroom like three times a day. We had three lunch periods, and I'd go hang out. You know, because I remember I was in English class and I raised my hand to go to the bathroom and I never came back. But
leave your backpack there, or did you take your backpack with you to the bathroom?
We didn't have backpacks back then.
When you guys carried your books and then you guys all
belt.
Had drag.
Oh yeah, you had a belt all, around it.
Yeah. And you guys all had drag. You guys had drag races after high school. I forgot you were
walking
Greece.
To school like Balky Bartokomous.
We had an old Jeff Ross bit on the end of our book.
Yeah.
So we, you know, but the lunchroom, like, you go to different, there was three periods and you would hang with different gangs or group of kids each period, you know, and bum money if you had to eat that, because you know you didn't have enough money for three fucking lunches. But, you know, and they had a jukebox in our lunchroom.
No, they didn't.
A jukebox?
Yeah, oh, yeah. Yeah, they did.
Did you go to Rydell High?
Thank you, Lou.
They had a jukebox? What kind of song? Did they have modern songs in?
We go together like whamma lamma lamma bonga dinga da bing boom.
It was a predominantly black high school, but they always played by David Bowie, Fame. When Fame came out, that was played all the time.
And so it was just David Bowie, and the rest was
Black Walk. That's a good 70s Black Walk song.
It was just one David Bowie song, and the rest was Earth, Wind, and Fire, every other song.
The Commodores or the Temptations. Yeah.
I can't listen to September again. Put on Bowie.
Yeah.
That's crazy, though. Would there be fights in the lunchroom for the jukebox?
I don't. You know what? I swear to God, I don't remember that. I don't think so. I don't think it was like the, you know,
any place where high school kids bottleneck, you always wonder about the fights that happen, because that's just, you know, you're just mixing a bunch of young teens going through stuff.
And there was always one dude who used to stand on the end of the lunch line bumming money. And there was this one dude, Kenny, and he had like a cross traveling eye, and he would sit there and go, "Oh man, let me get a quarter. Well, are you talking to me? Look at focus with your good eye," because his eye was just taken off all over the place, and he would just sit there trying to bum money. But then you had to tip him.
Yeah, but you should only tip him when his eyes lined together. When his eyes lined up, you go, there you go. Now I make a wish. Make a wish. All right, thank you.
Dan, did you, Rich, grow up at all with any version of hometown or school or whatever, like pride that was like seeping over with you, like neighborhood pride even, or like city? Like, well, I never gave a shit ever. If someone ever in my whole life was like, Philly sucks, I'm like, yeah, I'm sure there's an experience you could have there that would you say Philly sucks for sure.
I feel like you're all hometown Philly though. Like, you've been in New York 20 years and you're like Philly. Well, so I'm attached to it.
I'm attached to the sports teams. I'm a fan of the teams, and I like the food in the city because it says it's to me. Yeah. I'm saying I'm not. I don't have any investment of heart into it that if someone else goes, yeah, I hate that place you say you like, I go, sure, man. Like, yeah, absolutely. I don't like Florida. People love Florida. I hate it.
I grew up in Plainfield. Like, so Plainfield High, I didn't, you know, the rivalry on Thanksgiving was Plainfield versus Westfield. Everybody went to that game. Yeah. But no other thing. Like, I don't think we had bonfires when the city was on fire. You know what I mean? Like, I didn't give a fuck. You know, I got a Cardinal hat now just because I was, you know, I wanted to buy something.
Sure.
But you know what I mean? But I do say where I'm from. Like, I live in Hillsborough the last 15 years, but if someone goes, where are you from? I go, Plainfield, because yeah, Plainfield had, I mean, you know, Parliament Funkadelics were from Plainfield. There was some other, you know.
I still say I'm from Aurora, you know, where Roseanne Barr is from, where Tim Allen is from. Just keep up if you want. 225 made some stars. Okay?
I bet DJ Lou is from a place when he was younger where it's like, even if the next place was called north of what your south was, there was still a major, like, fight problem rivalry. You know what I mean? If he lived in, like, you know, South Haven, they fucking did war with North Haven.
don't even bring up East Haven.
Yeah, well, don't even run your mouth about it. I bet, Luke, did you grow up in like that kind of, Lou? Like, everyone had way too much pride in there where they were from locally?
Yeah, we used to fight at the Dairy Queen parking lot in Teaneck.
You know, yeah, we can't hear you.
Did they also have good sound equipment?
We used to fight at the Dairy Queen parking lot in Teaneck.
Who'd you fight?
Lactose intolerance? Come on now.
Wait, it was straight up just a race rumble?
Yeah.
No shit.
Yeah.
A total race war? No. We would have gotten dominated. We might have had numbers,
but they would have fucking, I think, yeah, black people.
No, I was in West Philly. I'm going to tell you, there was a time in South Philly where if you could somehow unite the Irish and the Italians, the whites could have won at a time, but in West Philadelphia, what? Not a fucking chance, dude.
You guys had a lot of bikers in Philly too, though. You know,
sure.
In Plainfield, it would have been, you know, the blacks against me, but you know, it was
Voss is like, I'm one man standing.
There is nothing funnier. There's nothing funnier than three old men, me, Lou, and Voss, talking about how tough our neighborhoods were. And we keep dialing back to now Rich is the only white person for miles.
Yeah.
I was like, there wasn't a ton of me growing up. It was probably like 70-30. DJ Lou was like, we had 80-20. Voss is like, I didn't know white people were a real thing. I thought something was wrong with me.
and then Witsky's like, I had to bop my way home the whole way. I had to fight through the rogues and through the...
A little bit of a race war, you know.
Crisp kids.
You knock a few blacks out, get yourself a Oreo Blizzard.
You know what I mean? You have your spring helter skelter, you fight your way through it, you know, full on race war.
You get yourself a chili dog.
I was in the gang, the warrior.
Yeah, the warrior.
He goes, it was great, though, because no one complained about my jacket designs.
I had, in fourth grade, This kid, Sonny, the leader of the gang, I was the only white dude in the gang. And Sonny was a month, you know, but he stole
my... How old was Sonny? If you were in fourth grade, how old was Sonny?
I don't know, 27?
Was he old enough to make an OnlyFans video while you were playing with your friends?
But Sonny was the leader of the gang, and he could fight. And his brother, yeah, Harvey, could fight. Dennis was the second strong. Anyhow, I was the only white kid. And he took my Hot Wheel car in class. It was either a Hot Wheel or a Matchbox car. And I told the teacher, which was the wrong thing to do.
Yeah, he snitched.
I'm telling you, a whole gang was chasing me home. Like, jeez, all you saw was like a white kid running in fucking saddle shoes with this. It looked like just like a black cloud chasing him. And yeah. Some lady stopped him and stopped him from. And the lady probably was like an 18-year-old teenager, you know.
Really, but to you, she could have been 18 or 40.
Yes.
The odds of you outrunning half of a black gang is impossible.
And I'm going to say I'm saying you flagged the lady down because you were gassed. I think you were. Like, I got to get this lady in between us.
I was quick. I could run. I'm fast as fuck. I was really fast. But this didn't go too far. This was right from the school to the next apartment building where that lady was, I think.
Yeah, lady, please help me.
Was she an older black lady?
No, she was a white lady, but I say lady, she probably could have been 18 or 19 years old. You know, I'm in fourth grade.
Okay, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, and you look like the Beatles with a group of kids chasing you.
It's funny. You're like, and those guys stopped chasing me. You never found out because they gang raped and killed that 18-year-old.
Oh,
and stuff.
No.
He goes, oh God, no! Why did I turn them on to her?
No,
I felt like Colin Quinn performing in Boston.
Yeah, man. The chasing home. I'm glad I never got chased home. I can't remember a moment where I was chased to my door. That has to be fucking terrifying.
I've never been like chased, like where I've had to run home, but I've definitely had Dave Smith when he got like robbed too. It was like this when he started telling the story, it takes like such back. But like I've seen the unfolding of like, oh, like they've zoned in on me somehow. Do you know what I mean? Like,
yeah,
these three guys who seem very unrelated are like definitely like zeroing in to figure out who they were going to try to like take money from or whatever. And then when you see that unfolding, you're really like,
yeah.
I would never outrun anybody, so I wouldn't waste my time gassing myself trying to run and then possibly have to fight. So I would just be like, what are we doing, guys?
Yeah, and they're like, nothing.
I try to big bear them. I get big.
When I was in high school, we had two like older, scary kids chase us into the backyard, and that was fucking terrifying.
But dude, that's a funny thing that you should do is run over to those situations and go, that's right, you guys want to fight? I'd live for this.
Yeah.
Just see if you can scare them away with words like that. Oh, 13 versus 1, this is my jam, dude. I'm so happy you guys picked me.
My Aikido master told me I shouldn't fight anybody, but it looks like I get to.
I've never jerked off in front of 14 people.
Yeah. Man,
we were coming home from school in high school. In high school, the gangs in high school were fucking ruthless.
Yeah, because they had adult bodies. You were dealing with.
And what part of Jersey is this, Rich?
Plainfield. So we're walking home, me and Mickey and this gang, these dudes, and I knew them all. came running up to us, and they look at Mickey and go, oh, that motherfucker threw a snowball at me yesterday, and was fucking May. And out of nowhere, out of fucking nowhere, pow, and his nose just started. They looked at me, and they go, don't fuck with him. He's cool. And then, bam, just hit Mickey. And there's nothing I could do because, you know, they just hit
him. So hold on. So these kids run up, and then they hit Mickey. And then what is – if I'm Mickey and you're standing there, I go, what the fuck, Rich? Why did you get fucking hit? I didn't throw a fucking snowball. I'd be so mad at you if I was your friend.
That's, what the that, fuck? That's very terrifying. It's very, very terrifying, though, when you could tell somebody making up something to be angry at you. You know what I mean?
Oh, my God.
Yo, yeah. It's like, this dude that called your daddy a pussy. And you're like,
No, I didn't.
I assumed he didn't have a daddy.
You only have
even
to go
worse.
That. You have to go through that once in your life of a fucking bigger or meaner kid being like, yeah, I heard you were talking shit about me. And you're like, I wasn't. What is this? What is happening? I am so scared of you.
By the way, that was the answer, even if you were. You go, what? Who said that? I want to kill that person who said that because they're lying.
Yeah.
I will challenge my entire friendship with that person so this moment doesn't happen.
I swear to God. Remember when swearing to God was a real thing? You're like, I swear to God.
He wouldn't do that. He wouldn't break that bond with the Lord.
I was cutting through the school, and I see my friend Timmy. And there's like four dudes around him and they're taking his watch or taking his shit, right? And I knew the dudes, but I couldn't walk over there because I had a half a pound of pot in my jacket. So I had to keep going because I couldn't take a chance of them taking my fucking weed or getting caught. So I went and Jimmy's looking at me going, yo, help. And I'm like, And I had to walk away.
Not today, dude.
Not today.
Oh, my God. Dude, if you're that friend, you're like, what the fuck, Rich? And then you have to be like, you want some free weed? And you're like, all right, yeah.
You should have just sang In the Air Tonight by Phil Collins.
Well, I remember.
I saw you were drowning. I did not lend a hand.
Oh, my God. You're getting beat up like that and watching your friend bail on you.
Dude, that's the worst.
Oh, look, he's going to help me. Where is he going? Where the fuck is he going?
In Ohio, I stood up to a bunch of people that were following me home, and I thought that I'd befriended one guy. I've told this before. This gigantic black dude named Kenny. He was one friend I made there just organically. He lived like a couple doors over from me.
Yeah.
A couple houses over from where my dad lived. And just huge. I mean, like, at this point, probably like 6'7", 6'8", but fat, but like big all around, and walked around carrying a big boombox.
Badass.
And when the guys were following me home, I was talking to him. He's like, yeah, it sucks, man. And I just blindly was like, well, I'll stand up to him because, like, this giant dude's here with me. And he's, like, got my back. And when I turned around, he just never stopped walking. Like, he just kept walking. And I turned around, and I had to fight Marcus that day.
Oh, man.
I brought this up on our podcast. I think, and Bonnie trashed me, but I was in my school all the way up to at least junior high. Brian Jenkins was the Duke of the school. Like,
Was he just the toughest kid?
He was the Duke. He was the toughest. Like,
was he the afternoon drive DJ? It's the Duke of the school.
You're listening to the toughest kid in high school.
But I knew Brian since like third grade, so I was his boy, you know. But he was the Duke, like, and on the west end of town at the other junior high, they had a Duke there, you know, whatever, you know. But our school,
did they call themselves Dukes? Did you assign the Duke? No,
his nickname was Tank, and he was the Duke. Everybody knew it. You
Tank
knew
Duke.
You knew you
Duke,
did not
Duke over Earl.
And then.
He goes, fall in line, I'm the Duke. And I go, well, that's funny, because I'm the Lord. I'm the Lord of the school. That's the way I'd play it.
I'm going to go take a Duke.
Yeah.
I was in sixth grade, and Carlos was the Duke of Emerson School. So this dude from North, do you see me spit?
I'm laughing at the crazy royalty scale you guys had at your high school.
Carlos was
the Duke of Emerson. So Lonnie moved in from North, but they knew he could fight. So we were in the bathroom, and Carlos and Lonnie had a fight, and me and Alvin got to sit up and watch the whole fight between Carlos the Duke and Lonnie. Like, and I'm some white dude just watching these two, and this was a real knockout fight in the bathroom. Carlos won, but he gave Lonnie, he said, you know what? You're all right with me.
Damn, so wait, you watched this super fight.
Duke versus Duke?
You saw the Duke and Duke super fight? You were one of two people?
Carlos and Lonnie, man. And if you're from Plainfield, if I said their last names, everybody would know, my age would know who they are.
They would know. These guys were tough as fuck.
Oh, the Dukes. I remember the day they did a 50-pace duel.
Hello, Lonnie. It is I, Carlos. I challenge you for your dukedom.
Yes. Lonnie. Loser. Loser leaves double duked. Let's we have to take a break.
Real quick, Bonnie and my kids, for Christmas, I bought everybody a 1 square foot piece of property in Scotland. So my wife and my daughters are ladies, and I'm a lord because we all own 1 square foot. We have the certificate that, you know, they're ladies and I'm a lord, you know, because I own a foot by a foot property in Scotland. So for now on, I'd like to be addressed Lord Legend, Richard.
Well, my lord, we need to take a break real quick.
But you have to get back on the road, Rich. Yeah. We got to get you back on the road. I don't like hearing that at all. Yeah, I got knighted by the internet.
Make sure you check out Rich Voss at the Atlantic City Comedy Club. Wait, is this one of those things where we have to come back and then say goodbye, Witzke?
Yep, that's one of those things again.
All right, so then we'll say goodbye to Rich.
Rich,
Rich is a fucking legend and hilarious. He's going to be at the Atlantic City Comedy Club this Friday and Saturday, April 9th and 10th. Get tickets at Atlantic City Comedy Club, all spelled out, atlanticcitycomedyclub.com. Go see him. It's a fucking good time. And Dan Soder. We'll do our plugs at the end, everybody.
Well, Rich, we love you. Thanks for stopping in, dude.
Thank you, Rich.
Thank you, guys. You guys are great, man.
And we'll be right back. It's the Bonfire.
And just like that, we're back. Hey, everyone. I hope you learned a valuable lesson today on the Bonfire. Chase your dreams, because you can grab them if you have someone else's capital. And that's the most important part.
Also, all you need is that capital.
Don't jerk off in the room with children. It's weird.
Or do it and then raise the price of your OnlyFans, I'd say.
That's also true.
Because to find that video right now, I'd throw that fucking $25.
Oh, shit. I am Goofball on Instagram. Christine brought this up because it's a shot on Jay. Says, I love the show, except now I'm pretty sure Jay actually doesn't understand investing and might just be letting his money devalue in a bank account.
I am Goofball. I appreciate your concern. I don't understand investing that much, but my money is not just sitting in a bank account, I promise.
Yeah.
And so Christine, to show that, just trying to take a little fucking shot. It's unnecessary. It makes no sense. My money isn't just sitting in a bank account.
It's in a firm that I also use as well that invests for us. It's part of being a client at the firm.
No, I don't have investments through them at all yet.
Oh, okay.
Well, so true. And by the way, I don't know shit about investments or real estate. My simple argument is neither does Christine, because she went to an office with her uncle when she was 12 and 15.
Well, we can discuss that later.
It's right shit bananas.
Go download the Bonfire podcast. Sometimes there's extra stuff because I'm so good at timing shows.
You're so good at it.
There's new episodes Tuesday through Friday. Go tell your friends that don't have Sirius to listen to the Bonfire podcast. All major platforms. Download, rate, view, and subscribe wherever you listen. And if you live in Kansas City, this Friday and Saturday, Jay is going to be at the Kansas City Improv. After that, he's going to be in St. Louis, Columbus, and Providence, Rhode Island. For tickets and other tour dates, visit BigJComedy.com.
And Dan, of course, going to be back on the road, Pittsburgh Improv, June 3rd.
Actually, Jay, this just in, on the commercial break, I believe you're going to be able to catch me in Indianapolis and Buffalo in May. Whoa! We're trying to work it out. Whoa! Yeah, Jerry O'Connell.
Hey, buddy.
Helium in Indianapolis, the 13th through the 15th, and Helium in Buffalo, the 20th through the 22nd. Let's go.
He's back. DanSoder.com for tickets to all those shows. All of them.
We're going to be back live tomorrow.
Yeah, I hope Christine. We'll see what Christine's net worth is tomorrow morning. She might have to come back. She might tell us to take this job and shove it.
That'd be very fun. That'd be a very fun episode.
I'm in escrow with a fucking high rise. We love you guys. We'll catch you tomorrow. Live tomorrow, yeah?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Right here. A live lost tape. Sorry, Jim McClure. Tomorrow. Until then, crackle, crackle.
Bye.